Okay, everybody, good morning. How's everybody doing? You had a good week? Anybody gonna complain you're too hot now? So, anyway, I just have a few announcements before we begin. I can tell you that Bible study is Tuesday night at 6:30. They are doing the seven deadly sins, and I did a sermon series a couple years on that, but years ago on that. But the seven deadly sins, board meeting Tuesday night at 7:30, and Thursday is United Methodist Women Luncheon, and they're bringing the big hitters in for this program. So Brenda Christensen will be the program. Brenda, would you like to say something now? No, I didn't think so. Would you like to talk to me afterwards alone? Yes. So, anyway, I can tell you that back in the back, there are forms for Easter flowers. We do not set the deadline for this. The florist does. And the deadline is March the 13th, so it's pretty fast. So you want to keep that in mind. Okay? So, Lisa, are you ready?
It's on, yes. Come on up. So we learned something today about the pretzel, right? Daphne, what did we learn?
We learned that it resembles peace.
If you hold it this way, it is peace, right? If you hold it this way,
it shows somebody praying.
It shows somebody praying. And back in like the 600s, there was this religious person called a monk who was making a Lenten treat for his brothers that lived with him. And he made a pretzel, and what did he do with his arms?
He did this.
He did this. So in the pretzel, you could see your arms coming like this way, because that's how they used to pray. They used to pray with their arms crossed. So we learned about the Lenten pretzel. So you each have like a little snack out there if you choose to take one, but remember to pray during Lent when you see a pretzel, right? Thank you, Daphne.
Lisa, I was afraid a couple were gonna stand up to get pretzels now, but they didn't, so that's good. So, okay, anybody else? Okay, if not, let us all enter into an attitude of worship. Very good. Let us all stand and sing our opening hymn, Just As I Am. Dear Father, as we come here this morning, we're thankful for the privilege of being here on this very first Sunday of Lent. We begin to realize that the clock is ticking, that the great day of Easter will be with us before we know it, and we have a lot of work to do before that time. And so may we seize this season, help us to recognize the shortcomings in our lives and correct them so that we can be a little bit more like Jesus every day. Once again, I'm thankful for your wonderful Holy Spirit that washes through our service, and we're thankful for your great commitment to us. And we just pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen. Now, in one voice, let us tell the world exactly what we believe by reciting the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God.
Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. Okay, before Tim reads the Psalter lesson to you, let me give you a couple prayer concerns. I want to tell you that Jim Stefanik is dealing with bladder cancer. He has surgery in a couple weeks. We'll keep Jim in our prayers. Lisa's daughter, Mark's daughter, Sydney Miller, is having knee surgery. She has cancer in her knee. And she's in California, 24 years old. We'll keep Sydney in our prayers. Her surgery is the 14th, correct? So, okay. I can also tell you that John fell and ended up in the hospital. He had internal bleeding. They've run a lot of scans. He's home now. I did talk to John a little bit yesterday. He would really appreciate our prayers, and I think we really need to pray for him. Okay, Madeline, Polly, we're glad you're here. Okay, well, Shirley, we're glad you're here, but it would be more fun if Howard and you both were here, but I get it, so we'll keep Howard in our prayers. Okay, Jackie Bragg was supposed to start this week. Got there, and for some reason they canceled, I don't know why. We've been praying for Linda Miller, Nancy Flanagan, and the three that are in the military, and what a time to be in the military. Okay, I have to say this, I have a unique perspective on the Ukrainian invasion. I'm more sucked into this than most news items. I know people in Russia, I know people in Ukraine. The first thing I did when this started was text Vlad. You remember Vlad was the boy that we brought over to get the prosthetic legs, and in a certain way is kind of a member of the family. And Vlad said, and I think for a lot of people in Russia, they don't want this war. They want peace. They want to be peaceful people. And this is all headed up by Putin. And that was how he felt. On the other hand, we know people in Ukraine, and they are suffering beyond belief. Every day via Facebook, I get a little video that friends pass on to me, and I've passed on to some of you, of what their life is like. This young man lives in Kivero, which is southern Ukraine, headed towards the Crimea, and every day you can hear the stress in his voice just a little bit more. The last one I saw were of sirens going off. And so I'm always relieved to get a video because I know he's alive, and it's that simple. So we need to pray for this thing. People have asked me about making a donation. We're going to send the money through the United Methodist Committee on Relief. That means that every dollar you give will go there. If you want to make a check out to the church, that's fine. But on the memo, just say Ukraine, and we'll make sure that it gets to where you want it to go. Okay? So if you have any unspoken prayer concerns, if you'd like to raise your hand. Okay. Tim, you ready? During the season of Lent, I'm going to use the confirmation kids to read the scriptures. So, Tim, it's your turn. Then you can heckle the other ones later or something. But and since you're taller than me, I'm moving you up.
Go for it.
Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Many are saying of me, God will not deliver him. But you, Lord, are my shield, you are a shield around me. My glory, the one who lifts my head high. I call out to the Lord, and he answers me from his holy mountain. I lie down and sleep. I wake again because the Lord sustains me. I will not fear, though tens of thousands assail me on every side. Arise, Lord, deliver me, God. Strike all my enemies on the jaw. Break the teeth of the wicked. From the Lord comes deliverance. May your blessing be on your people.
Okay, will you please pray with me? Dear God, as we come into prayer this morning, we're thankful that you're a great big God, a powerful God, an all-knowing God. Because, Father, you're the kind of God that our world needs because it's a complex place. We think about the people of Ukraine. We pray for the people of Ukraine. We pray for Christians in Eastern Europe and the anxiety that they're living with today. And we pray for peace. Senseless killing is just that. It's senseless. And so we pray for the people that we are so concerned about, and we just pray that this conflict come to an end quickly so that we can just resume our lives. Father, we recognize that in America we live in a wonderful country, we've had wonderful opportunities, and yet we're not isolated in the world. We are part of the world community, and I just pray for our own country, and may we be thankful where we were born. I don't know if we won the lottery or what it was, but we were born here and we all have good lives and we're thankful. And so certainly we pray for Christians around the world. We pray for Christians in our own country. We pray for the various activities of our church. I lift a Bible study to you, and it's important. It's like sitting at the feet of Jesus and listening. We're supposed to be making progress in our spiritual development. I lift up the confirmation class, and I pray for them, and it's not just memorizing lists of things, it's cultivating that relationship with Jesus that's so important. We pray for Sunday school, we pray for choir, we pray for everybody that does something in this church to make it a better organization, but what we really want to be is part of the body of Christ himself. So once again, we lift up people that we are concerned about at this moment, and we pray for them. I certainly ask you to be with Jim as he anticipates the surgery. Certainly, Sydney, we lift her to you. We lift her extra high to you. And when I was 24 years old, I was doing things that 24-year-olds do. 24-year-old should not be having surgery, and we struggle with that, so we lift her extra high to you. Be with Lisa as she travels back and forth from California, and may she realize, make her realize that there are a lot of people in this church that are concerned and that are praying. I lift up our good friend John Meredith. I'm thankful that Madeline's here. We lift up Howard to you today. I lift up Jackie as she goes through this treatments that she has to have. And certainly we pray for Linda and Nancy as well. But Father, we come during this season of Lent because it's a man-made season, and yet we realize that it's a short season, and yet we need to seize the opportunity in this short season to be determined to make some progress in the faith. Once again, we're thankful for all that we have, but with all that we have, we realize that the greatest thing that we have is our relationship with Christ. Once again, we're thankful for the Master and thankful for the way that he taught us all to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is
the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now
And all of God's people said,
Hallelujah.
During this season of Lent, we're going to spend some time in the Gospel of John. I picked John because John kind of looks at everything from a different perspective. And there'll be six messages in all. I started on Wednesday night, Ash Wednesday, and we'll go from there. It's a little bit of background might be helpful for you. First of all, John was written about the year 85 by John, the disciple whom Jesus loved. Interesting that he wrote it, but his name is never mentioned once in the gospel. But it's clear that John knew an awful lot about Jewish society and way of life. He understood the practices, the beliefs, and he certainly understood the geography. It's almost as if he writes these words for two groups. There is the non-believing group, and he writes to them to prove to them that Jesus was this long-awaited Messiah. But also he writes to people that believed, and what his words do is encourage them to live out the faith. The central theme can be found in that famous piece of scripture, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believeth him will not perish, but have eternal life. It's the entire Bible summarized in just one verse. This is the very first Sunday in Lent, and our scripture reading for today is John 3:1-8, and I've called this message today, Are You Born Again? Okay, I'm going to show you the video, and the videos are all from the movie The Gospel of John. Okay, we'll see the video every week, and then we'll hear the scripture, and after the video, you can read. Okay? Very good.
While Jesus was in Jerusalem during the Passover festival, many believed in him as they saw the miracles he performed. But Jesus did not trust himself to them, because he knew them all. There was no need for anyone to tell him about them, because he himself knew what was in their hearts. There was a Jewish leader named Nicodemus, who belonged to the party of the Pharisees. One night, he went to Jesus.
Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher sent by God. No one could perform the miracles you are doing unless God were with him.
I am telling you the truth. No one can see the kingdom of God without being born again.
How can a grown man be born again? He certainly cannot enter his mother's womb and be born a second time.
I am telling you the truth. No one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. A person is born physically of human parents, but is born spiritually of the Spirit.
Do not be surprised because I tell you that you must all be born again. The wind blows wherever it wishes. You hear the sound it makes, but you do not know where it comes from. Where it is going. It is like that with everyone who is born of the Spirit. How can this be? You are a great teacher in Israel, and you don't know this. I am telling you the truth. We speak of what we know and report what we have seen, yet none of you is willing to accept our message. You do not believe me when I tell you about the things of this world. How will you ever believe me then when I tell you about the things of heaven? And no one has ever gone up to heaven except the Son of Man who came down from heaven.
Very good. Let us all stand for the gospel reading.
Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him." Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. How can someone be born when they are old?" Nicodemus asked. "Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born." Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, 'You must be born again.' The wind blows whenever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit."
The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. If you're thankful for Tim, say amen.
Amen.
All right. Maybe there's a preacher in there, Tim, waiting to get out, you know, just... You're not going to answer, huh? I just died. Anyway, you did great. You did great. So will you please pray with me? Dear Father, as we come here today, we'll admit it, we live in complex times. And it's at those moments that we're thankful that you are a great big God. We will admit it, that we are not perfect people. Lent is a season for people like us, sinners. And we're thankful that we have forgiveness in Jesus. The times in which we live are perfect for Jesus because our world is desperate for some hope. And finally, Father, we'll all admit it, that our own death bothers us, so we'd like to live for eternity, but in this world it's not going to happen. But we can live for eternity in heaven itself, and we're thankful. And that's possible because of Jesus. And so once again, I just ask that you just pour the gift of preaching through me, that through my simple words we may experience your word, so we can apply those words to our daily lives. Once again, we pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen. We find ourselves today in the third chapter of John. And John is different than the other Gospels, the Synoptic Gospels. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John have a different storyline. The storyline in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, is that it has the cleansing of the temple at the very end. It's kind of part of the climax of what's going to happen. It's the beginning of all that. John is different. John has the cleansing of the temple at the very beginning. That fact is important for one reason, and that fact is important because it means that Jesus had the attention of influential people from the very beginning. And it's still true today. If you want to get people's attention, just try to touch their money, and everybody get excited. One of those influential people was Nicodemus. And according to the second half of the first verse, it says that he is a member of the Jewish ruling council. That means that he has climbed to the top of his profession. And it would not be unusual that he would spend his day answering questions that people would bring to him because they wanted his wisdom and they wanted his advice because he was so respected. It's an unusual story because in this story, Nicodemus is not answering the questions. Nicodemus is asking the question. And if you want to distill the passage down to just kind of basic stuff, okay, core thing, it's really nothing more than a discussion between Jesus and Nicodemus. Verse 2, we've made a big deal about it for a long time. In that verse, it says that Nicodemus went to Jesus at night. That fact is curious, and we've debated for a long time why he came at night. Some people believe that he went at night to hide his identity. You know, you can scurry around in the dark, you know, and people won't see you. Some people believe that Nicodemus was trying to save his reputation. How would it look for a respected rabbi, member of the Jewish ruling council, to go to Jesus, an itinerant preacher, a guy with no credentials. How would it look? Other people say, no, you're wrong. He went at night because the work of the day was over. And at night, he would have time to sit and talk with Jesus because there was nothing else really to do for the day. Nicodemus recognizes that Jesus is a significant person, as believes in the miracles, and understands that he could not have done this on his own, that he must have come from God. And so he's impressed with Jesus. Verse 3 there, if you look at it with me, it says that Jesus talks about the kingdom of God. And he says that nobody can enter the kingdom of God, not even a member of the Jewish ruling council, unless they are born again. It's an interesting phrase, and people have wrestled with it for years, and people are almost uncomfortable with that phrase, you must be born again. We've been wrestling with that line for 2,000 years. It's not surprising that Nicodemus had a difficult time with it on that particular night. Jesus says that there must be two births in life. There is the physical birth, you know, giving birth to a child, you know, that's physical birth. But there's also a spiritual birth that suddenly you're born again. Physical birth, okay, is hard for us to comprehend being born again, because if it's just physical, it's awkward and it's uncomfortable. When you were born physically as a child, you don't remember this, but you struggled for life. When we hear the baby cry, it just means that the baby is trying to breathe. And we celebrate because the child is alive and breathing, but the child is fighting to exist. And the child is the center of his or her universe themselves. Spiritual birth is different. It means that when you're born again, it means that the center of your universe is God. And the center of your universe is trying to please God in a certain way. We're all born physically, but only a few, the minority, has a spiritual second birth. So let me ask you, which is more important to you? Are you the center of your universe, or is God the center of your universe? It's a question that won't go away. Have you been born again? Now, let me take it just a little farther with you, okay? Just a little bit farther. We believe that God exercises free will, okay? In other words, God may be directing history in the big picture, but free will says simply this, that on an individual basis, we make the choice, and the choices we make, we are responsible for the choices that we make. And life is really nothing more than a series of choices. I read this, I don't know if it's true, I read it on the internet. You can't always trust the internet. I read on the internet that the average person makes 35,000 choices in a single day. That seems hard to believe. Some of the choices are simple choices with short consequences, like you're sitting there now going, what should I have for lunch? It's a short-term decision. Some choices are more long-term, like what are you going to do with the rest of your life? You know, we drag graduates up here, we ask them, what are you going to do? And they're 18 years old, there's a whole world out there, and we ask them, what are you going to do with your life? It's a hard question. And some questions have eternal consequences. Like, have you been born again? Are you going to accept Jesus into your life? So the question for the day is, are you born again? Have you decided to follow Jesus? Is that the choice that you've made? Are you going to live with you being the center of your life, or are you going to live with God being the center of your life? The wind blows where it may, the choice is yours. Are you born again? What's more important to you, yourself or God? I'm going to help you answer that question, are you born again, by asking you three secondary questions, okay? And I think when you answer these three questions, you'll have know if you're born again or not. Here's the first question. The first question is God pleased with the way that you're spending your time? Okay? I mean, how much of your time are you really giving to God? One of the great stories in the Bible is the story of Mary and Martha. And you know the story, it's the 10th chapter of Luke. And Mary and Martha were the sisters of Lazarus, the one that Jesus resurrected. They lived in Bethany, a couple miles outside of Jerusalem. Jesus had an open invitation. And when he would go to Jerusalem, he would stop by and see him. And whenever Jesus would stop by, there'd be a big party. And Mary and Martha opened their home up to Jesus, but when Jesus arrived, Mary throws a curveball at everybody. What she does is that she sits at the feet of Jesus, remember, and she listens to Jesus. And whatever Jesus said, she heard it firsthand. There's no secondhand knowledge. She hears what Jesus is saying. And every time I'm in the kitchen of this church, somebody always goes, "We're like Martha, you know. We're always busy and we're working and we're doing all these things." Martha was busy cooking and cleaning and getting out the hand towels and all those things you got to do. And she gets tired of it. She's doing all the work. She goes to Jesus to want to reprimand Mary. But instead, Jesus applauds Mary. Why? Because the priorities in her life are correct. The priorities in her life was Jesus. Martha was not doing bad things, but she was just doing good things. Mary, on the other hand, was spending her time doing the best thing. So let me ask you, how are you spending your time? Is God pleased with the way that you're spending your time? Now, I'm not talking, okay, about sinister things. Nobody here is a drug dealer. You know, there's nobody here that's embezzling funds or anything like that. But you know that it's true. It's easy in life to fill our lives with good things. You know, how much of your time do you spend working? You got to work. How much time do you spend worrying about your family? How much time do you spend with your friends? How much time have you ever sat in a church meeting that lasted an hour, but it seemed like it was 3 hours? Okay? How many times have you said, "I can't do that right now. I can't go to church because I'm exhausted from working at the fundraiser"? Get it? Is God pleased with the way you're spending your time? It's a question of priorities, and it challenges our priorities. What's more important to you, the good things in life or the best things in life? The best thing in life is Jesus. Is God pleased with the way that you're spending your time? If that makes you think, say amen. Here's question number two. Is God pleased with the way that you're spending your money? Okay, in 1965, Ferdinand Marcos became president of the Philippines. Okay, that meant that his wife, Imelda Marcos, became the first lady. And he was in office from 1965 to 1986. Okay, they had to leave the Philippines and they left behind all their possessions. And the media went bonkers with the stuff that they left behind. They ruled a really poor country. I've been there. It's a poor country. But when they left, Imelda Marcos left behind 15 mink coats. She left behind 508 gowns, 1,000 handbags, and they say up to 7,500 pairs of shoes. Okay? It's important that you know that I only own 4 pairs of shoes and one that has a hole in the bottom when I do yard work. But she owned 7,500 pairs of shoes. And Imelda Marcos, for a while there, was deemed to be the most selfish person in the history in the world at that particular time. Have you ever thought if they could have used that wealth, how they could have actually help people around the world? And I had to look this one up. Imelda Marcos actually went to jail at the age of 89, okay? And she went to jail for corruption for 42 years. I don't think she'll see the end of that sentence. So here's the question. Is God pleased with the way that you're spending your money? We only spend our money, we say this every November, on things that are important to us. And so the things that we buy are the most important things to us because you can't buy everything. So take an inventory of what you buy, okay, with your money, because funds are limited and you only buy things that are important. How do you spend your money? How much of your money do you spend on yourself? Okay? How much money do you spend on your family? How much money do you give to the church, the bride of Christ, to keep the ministry going? How much money do you spend responding to human need? Imelda Marcos owned 7,500 pairs of shoes. That's a lot of money. Is God pleased with the way that you're spending your money? It's all a matter of priorities. If you can answer that honestly, I think you'll be able to answer the question, are you born again? Are you the focal point of your life, or is God the focal point of your life? And the third question maybe is a hybrid of the two. Is God pleased with your personal witness? Okay? We're only in this world for a short time, and I said it last week. This is not the main event. Heaven's the main event. And when you leave this world, those that are left behind, how are they going to remember you? You know, you're not going to use a paragraph to explain who you were. Most of us only get a sentence. Are they going to remember you as a kind person? Are you going to be remembered as a generous person? Are you going to be remembered as a loving person or a selfish person? Are you more passionate about your favorite team or God? It's a fair question. Imelda Marcos owned 7,500 pairs of shoes. That's how we remember her. How are you going to be remembered? Is God pleased with your personal witness? Are you born again? Remember, if we're not born again, then we're simply living for ourselves. But if we are born again, then we're living for God. The last couple days, weeks, whatever, it's almost like watching history. On February the 24th, Russians invaded Ukraine, ordered by Vladimir Putin, and it was incredible to watch. People have talked to me about it because they know we've spent time in that part of the world, and people seem to think that this was like an instant thing, like the Russians and the Ukrainians loved each other for generations. It just isn't true. The Russians and the Ukrainians have always had tension there. And I don't claim to be an expert on Eastern European history, but some people say that it all goes back about 100 years, the Bolshevik Revolution. And when the Bolsheviks, Lenin, were going on and seizing control in Russia, the Ukrainians didn't support them. And when they didn't support them and the revolution was over, the Bolsheviks won to get the Ukrainians back. And so even though they were the breadbasket of the Soviet Union, there was a period where they starved the Ukrainians. They grew the food and they got it out of Ukraine. And the people suffered because they were being punished. The Ukrainians hated the Russians for that reason. The next thing that happened was that in 1991, Soviet Union dissolved. And what happened was that Ukraine became its own country, and they were happy with that. And in 2005, they had the Orange Revolution, and the Orange Revolution was that they got tired of their puppet president appointed by Putin, and they rebelled and forced him out. And Putin was frustrated with that, and so he decided that he was going to take it back. And remember, it wasn't that long ago, he just walked into Crimea and without a single shot and took it over. And so this latest invasion really is not something new. It's just a continuation of what's been going on between Russia and Ukraine for a long time. But this time, the Ukrainians are fighting back. And what they say Putin wanted was a fast victory, and like Hitler wanted a fast victory in World War II with the Blitzkrieg, and he was impatient, Putin wanted a fast victory, and it didn't come, and he's frustrated. And they say that things will even get worse. It'll get more personnel, he'll attack more civilians, because he's frustrated he didn't get this fast victory. Every night, I look at various news outlets and I just want to see the videos. I'm always choked up when I see those videos of parents, mothers and fathers, you know, walking to the Polish border, and there are their children with them. And they're happy that they're in Poland, but they left everything behind. And have you seen it? It says there that fathers, husbands, you know, they'll hug their children, they'll hug their wife, they kiss their children, they kiss their wife. And you know what they do? They go back. They go back to Ukraine to fight against the Russians. They're going back to Ukraine to support the families. They're going back to sell whatever they have. And they ask one man, why? Why are you doing this? And he pointed to his children. He said, I have to go back for them, so that they have a future. And he's willing to change everything in his life because he loves his children. The story is really the story of the Christian faith. We love in a powerful way, and love has a way of making us want to change for those that we love. So how much do you love God? How much are you willing to change for God? How much are you willing to sacrifice for God? We're not afraid to change for the people that we love. So how much do we love God? So how are you going to change spending your time? How are you going to change spending your money? How are you going to change spending your witness? Are you the center of your universe, or are you born again, where God is the focal point of all that you do? It's the question that just won't go away. Are you born again? And all of God's people said,
Amen.
Let us all pray. Dear Father, we're thankful for this day and this time together. We recognize that there's a lot of stigma involved with that question, and the issue of being born again always seems to divide us down the middle. But the truth is this: we must be born again if we're going to heaven. And so I ask that you just help us to take ourselves out of the center of our universe and replace ourselves with you. Once again, it is your will, nothing more, nothing less, nothing else. And all of God's people said,
Amen.
In the 11th chapter of 1 Corinthians, it says this. It says, For I received from the Lord what I pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let us all say the prayer of humble access together. We do not presume.
Gracious Lord,
so to partake of his sacrament, thy Son, Jesus Christ, that we may work in the newness of life, may grow into his likeness, and may ever dwell in him, and he in us.
This is the body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let us eat it in remembrance of him. And this is the blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let us drink it in remembrance of him. Will you please pray with me? Dear God, as we come here at this moment, it's this very first Sunday of Lent, we recognize that the next few weeks are sacred weeks in our lives, that as true disciples of Jesus Christ, we're never satisfied with our present state, but we're always striving for perfection. Give us the strength that we need to strive. Once again, we're thankful for your love for us all. We're thankful for this invitation to come to the table so that we could be one with you. Once again, we pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen. Now let us all stand and sing our closing hymn, For the Bread Which You Have Broken. The Son and God the Holy Spirit bless, preserve, and keep you all now and forevermore. Amen. Everybody have a good week.